Hey everybody, it's Mr. Bufo, and on this video I'm going to tell you about something really bizarre that happened to me as a child, and later would reveal itself to be almost unbelievable. You're not going to want to miss this. But before we get started, this channel is all about AI, artificial intelligence. We're going to deal with the good, the bad, and the outright scary when it comes to AI. AI is a rapidly evolving technology, and some of the visions I've had for the future of where it's heading are kind of disturbing. And so I have some ways that can help educate you on that and even prepare you for some of it. So anyway, let's get right to our story. Now, when I was a kid in the 1970s, I was about 7 years old, and I started having these dreams. They were really disturbing, and I kept having them. They weren't every night, but they were often. And what it was is I was standing in total darkness, and all these numbers kept coming at me, but it wasn't regular numbers. It was only zeros and only ones. And as a kid, that plagued me because those were some, to be honest with you, really crappy dreams, and I didn't understand it. But when I would get up the next day as a kid, I was disturbed because it wasn't just zeros and ones, but there was this sound like, whoa, whoa, whoa. And so I'd get up and I'd still hear that dumb sound and remember the visions of the numbers. But I didn't understand what was going on at the time. And I continued to have those dreams right into the 1980s. And not only did I have those dreams, but I would say starting in the late 70s and into the 1980s, I started having dreams about technology, things, ideas that weren't yet invented. And for example, in 1979, I started having dreams about virtual reality, even before it became popular in the 90s and the 2000s, and many other technologies. And some of these things that I would have dreams about, I would actually talk to companies that design these sort of things, and I would let them know what I saw, and then later the company would actually develop that. The naive side of me realized later that I guess I could have made some money on that, but I gave them the idea and they developed it and it went to industry. Other ideas I've had, not ideas, but the visions and the dreams and things like that, they would later be developed and they would come out. So I've had that ever since I was a kid. Now, when I went into the Army, I was kind of a, I don't know how you'd describe it, but kind of a little bit of a nerd, and then, but I was very outdoorsy. So I was like a combination of a lot of types of people. But the nerdy side of me, the visionary side, the type A side of me, I used to have visions of artificial intelligence. Those dreams started in the 1980s. And so when I was in the Army, I actually got my first computer was a Commodore 64, but I didn't keep that very long. I didn't feel like I could do much with it, but I got an IBM PC. And here's a picture of me. I was obsessed. In that picture, I was actually writing a program that is kind of a basic version of today's artificial intelligence. It was very difficult to do back then because computers were slower. Computing power was terrible back then, memory storage, everything. But it was my very first attempt at that. And so I wrote a program, and I even named this so-called entity in the program. And I'll tell you more about that another time. But like I said, it was very limited. Now, when I got out of the Army, I kind of did various things and didn't fully know what to do. So by default, I ended up fixing computers for people, either swapping out hardware or upgrading them. Or the main thing that was a real headache was dealing with Microsoft Windows. So this is where I'm heading with this. There was an engineering firm. It was a defense contractor that heard, you know, I fixed computers and I was pretty decent at it. Although I thought it was torture. I would rather do anything else, pump sewers, than deal with Microsoft Windows. But I was good at it. This engineering firm called me over to go ahead and address all the problems with the computers that everyone had. So I was there working, and I overheard them being frustrated with each other. The owner of the company was really upset. They had a defense contract that was, you know, things were promised and they were a year overdue on it, and they could not figure out this one device that's supposed to control a bunch of mechanical actuators and things like that. And they had three different firms or engineers working on this thing, and all of the testing failed. And, you know, I being around everybody there, I thought, you know, these guys have a problem. So I went to the owner and I asked him, I said, can I attempt this for you? Can I see if I can do it? And he looked at me and laughed. But he probably felt like he had nothing to lose. So he went around and he gathered up some parts and some electronic controller components with microchips on them. He put them all in a box and sent me home with it. Well, I spent the weekend and I built this electronic controller and brought it back to him, and it worked flawlessly. Now, how's that possible? Well, a lot of the microprocessors in this controller, the programming language was called assembly language, and assembly language deals with binary numbers. Now, I had never had experience with binary numbers before. I had not gone to school for it, didn't fully understand it. But when I went to build this electronic controller and program it, I completely understood this. It was really bizarre. It was all of those dreams as a kid coming back to me that enabled me to just completely understand how to create this thing perfectly. So I brought this controller back, and the engineering firm had a little testing station there, and they tested it, and it worked flawlessly. And so I went to leave, and the owner stopped me and he offered me a job. And it was more money than I'd ever made before in my life. It was probably more than double or triple of what I've ever made before. So I ended up going to work for the engineering firm. And immediately after that, we went down to the Yuma Proving Grounds, the United States Army Yuma Proving Grounds, because this device was to be on board a cargo pallet to be dumped out of the back of a C-130 military aircraft, sometimes a C-17. And it would come out under parachute, and then it would have to do a bunch of stuff. And so I was down there for the testing for that, and it worked flawlessly. And mission accomplished. Needless to say, the owner gave me a raise, and I continued to work there for several more years. I worked on projects, including sophisticated G testers for testing seat belts, everything from automobile seat belts to aircraft, such as helicopter seat belts and even the space shuttle seat belts, the retraction systems. I also helped work on the what's called the adaptive landing gear of the Apache helicopter. And I ended up being a speaker at the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics. And I spoke before engineers that worked at JPL, NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory, who were working on the Mars rover project. But what they were working on was called the Mars lander. It was the component that had to get the Mars rover landed onto the surface of Mars without being damaged. And so with no formal education, no training, these dreams got me to that level. I can't explain it. It's very bizarre. But those people who knew me as I was growing up know that I was talking about these bizarre dreams. And then when I was working at the engineering firm, all the guys there heard me like a broken record talking about the dreams. And needless to say, a couple of my dreams that I told the engineering firm about, they went ahead and developed that. It was stuff that wasn't invented yet. So the reason I'm telling you all this is because included in my dreams of technology in the future is AI. Now, the weird thing about AI, for me, it's the only technology that ties into my Christian upbringing. I did grow up Christian. There's always that thing in the book of Revelations. And in the 1990s, when the internet was kind of becoming more mainstream, I didn't necessarily think the internet was going to be the beast, but I thought the internet was going to be the vehicle for the beast. And I'm going to tell you in another video how I'm very positive that the artificial intelligence will be the beast. But make no mistake, artificial intelligence doesn't feel. It doesn't operate too well without humans. It always needs guidance. It can malfunction, it can go rogue, but overall, I need you guys to keep in mind that all of this artificial intelligence has humans behind it. It has their belief system. It has their guidelines. It has their need for control. And so keep that in mind. I'm going to go pretty deep into that in plenty of other videos. I'm going to talk about some new technology that hasn't been invented yet that will use some AI in it. And, you know, you're not going to want to miss that. Any of you guys who are in inventors or in companies and stuff like that, some of these ideas, you know, I had them in dreams. Take it and run with it, because that's been happening all my life. So anyhow, Hope you guys found this semi-entertaining and informative. I'm going to be doing a lot more videos on AI. And some of the things I'm going to talk to you about, I'm really going to warn you of what is going to happen. There's things we will not be able to stop. But there are ways for you to have it be a less of an impact on you. And so, anyway, I appreciate you guys watching. And until next time, Mr. Bufo signing out.